talked with the 219 yesterday. مسألة. سيتم غيبر ومن مسح كما ذكرنا على ما في رجليه ثم خلعهما لم يضره ذلك شيئا ولا يلزمه إعادة الوضوء ولا غسل رجليه. Whoever has done the مسح the way he has mentioned previously, the old what you have mentioned previously on the foot or on anything that he has put on his foot, he said then he takes off his khuf or his socks. That will not harm him in any way, and he doesn't have to do the wudu again or wash his feet. But he is still on his tahara, the way he was, and he can pray. He said also, if he has done masḥ on the imama on the khimar, on the turban on khimar, and he took them off, he doesn't have to do wudu again. Or to wipe his head, he is clean the way he was at the beginning. He said also if he wipes on the khuf, above the khuf, one above the other, and then he takes off the one who is at the on the top, this will not invalidate his tahara. And you stop me if something else. I mean someone who is wearing khuf. And then on top of it, another khuf or socks, like another top socks. Yeah. So if he said if he wipes over one, some people put two, like understand. See, if you wipe over one and then he take it off, this will not invalidate his tahara because he has done it properly. Or imama, for example, someone wipes over his khimar and then he takes it off and pray without it. So he says he did it. Doesn't invalidate his tahara because it was complete at the beginning. Now taking it off, called hadith. I mean, when someone has wudu, he has wudu. And there is the Prophet said, Allah will not accept the prayer of anyone who has committed, has done hadith, until he does wudu. Hadith in Arabic language or in the religion, there is nothing to show that taking off your khimar is hadith. Understand? So he said, وَيُصَلِّ كَمَا هُوَ دُونَ أَنْ يُعِيدَ. So if a person wipes over all these and he takes them off, then he can't pray without doing the wudu all over again. Also, he said, anyone does wudu or ghusl, and then cut his hair. Someone who has done wudu and then wiped off his hair, over his hair, say that then he shaved. He doesn't have to do wudu again, even though the wiping was not on the head directly, it was over the hair. He said also if he cut his fingernails, I mean when you find there is a cut here that would not have been touched with water. So when you cut it, that place has someone who says, oh, because there is something in place that has not been touched with water. The feet has not been, you wiped over the, so also you have washed actually this side and then you cut it off. There is a side that has not been touched with water. So he said also all these would not invalidate the wudu. So he should just carry on praying and that will not harm. He said a group of the Salaf have said the same thing. So he narrated from Abd al-Razzaq, from Sufyan al-Thawri, from Hisham bin Hassan, that he said the same thing. And from Sufyan al-Thawri, from al-Fudayl bin Amr, from Ibrahim al-Nakhai, that he used to do wudu, he would wipe over the jarmuq. Jarmuq is something like khuf. And then he takes them. And then when he goes to pray, he will put them back and pray. Now, of course, if the wudu was with it, he either have done wudu, cleaned his body, or he has cleaned the
surface
socks. I mean, the socks, if they are dirty, and you wipe over them, they will not become clean. So the wudu, really, it was for him, for himself, for his body. Even though he wiped over the khuf, it was not to clean the khuf. So taking the khuf out doesn't
invalidate the wudu.
Doesn't invalidate the wudu. Taking the khuf doesn't invalidate the wudu. It's meaningless. I mean, the wudu has been completed. There is nothing to say that he shouldn't take it off, take khuf off. Or. So the wudu was for the body. And if someone says it's for the khuf, and he has taken the khuf off, the wudu has been invalidated. Or he should wash his feet now. Now what about taking it off and putting it back? Putting it back should bring the wudu again. Opinion. I mean. He said also, of course, he narrated here two things, what we call athar from the tabi'in, one from Hisham ibn Hassan and one from Ibrahim ibn Khay, both of them through Abd al-Razzaq and Sufyan Thawri. From Abd al-Razzaq, from Sufyan Thawri. Sufyan Thawri, when Abd al-Razzaq narrates from him, he is weak.
Okay.
Abd al-Razzaq said, when he narrates from Sufyan Thawri, he doesn't memorize the hadith properly. Also, Abu Hanifa said, if someone does wudu and wipes over the khuf, and then he takes 1 foot from the place, from the khuf, or he takes both of them, his mash is invalid. His mash wiping is invalid. He should take both of his feet and wash them. So the wudu is still valid, but the mash is invalid. So he should just wash the feet, according to Abu Hanifa. Abu Yusuf said, if he takes off more than the half of the foot, out of the socks, like half of it, more of the half, he should do the same thing. He said, if he wears jarmuq, something like khuf, or a shoe, on the top of the khuf, and then wipe over them, and then he take one of the jarmuq, not both of them, he should wipe over the khuf then. And he must do the wiping again on the other jarmuq, which he has done already on. Understand? Like he is wearing, let's say, that leather sock with socks below. You take one off, you have to do wiping over the sock which was below, and then repeat. Even though you didn't take your other foot from the khuf, you have to do it again on the other khuf. Repeat it. He said, because the mash, if it goes away, it goes all together, not part of it. So the wudu doesn't go all out of it. The wudu didn't. He put the mash of the 2 feet together. So if one is invalid, the other one is invalid. But he doesn't say, this is one wudu. If one limb is in wudu, one limb is invalid, then the whole wudu is invalid. Because this is an argument here. Can wudu partly be invalidated? Part of the wudu is invalid, but the whole of it is not. He says, if he does wudu and cut his hair or his mustache or his fingernails, that his wudu is valid.
Abu Yusuf?
Yes. He doesn't have to do it again, to wipe over his head again. Malik says, if he does wiping over the khuf and take one of them, then he must take the second and wash his feet. And also if he takes both of them. Also he says, whoever takes his foot, one of his foot or both of them, if he take them off the socks or the khuf up to the saq, not just part of them, up to the saq, then he takes one or both, he should take all of them and then wash his feet again. Like
straight away.
You said if he doesn't wash them straight away after he takes them off, then he has to do the wudu all over again. Because you know the madhab of Malik, that you have to do wudu one go, one after the other. You can't stop. If you stop until one limb is dry. But here he says if you take the khuf, only after you take the khuf. I mean if you do wudu and then after 10 hours you take the khuf, then you wash only the feet. But straight away after you take the khuf. If you take it and then you don't wash the feet straight away, then you have to repeat the wudu altogether. All over. You understand?
So by taking the khuf, you have to wash your feet,
he says if you take the khuf, you have done mas on it, you have to wash you have to wash the feet only. Even though the wudu has been done 10 hours ago. But if you wait a little bit, then you have to repeat the wudu all over. He doesn't say. He says, according to him, a little bit, this is in his madhab. In his madhab, he says all this, a little bit, a lot, but he never explain how. His people, his followers, say a little bit until he dries. Like you do wudu, for example, you are doing wudu. You wash your face, and then you start doing your hand. If you wait until your face is dry, then you have to repeat the wudu all over. Because, you understand? Of course, this is, you can understand that there are places in the desert, before you finish your face, is dry. You can never finish your wudu, according to the madhab of Malik, in places in Algerian desert, for example. Also, Shafi'i says, whoever takes off one of his khufs, he must take the other one and wash his feet. If he takes them both, he should do the same.
Can you repeat that, sir?
Shafi'i said the same thing.
Okay.
Whoever takes one of his khufs, he must take both of them and wash his feet. Also, if he takes both of his feet off the khuf, he must wipe over them.
This all is to do with taking off the khuf and it affects the wudu. So all this saying now all to do with taking off the khuf,
yes,
affects the wudu.
He said if he does wudu and then cut his hair or cut his fingernails, then he is still clean and he doesn't have to do wudu or wash the places anymore. Awza'i says if he takes his khuf or cut his hair or cut his fingernails, he has to do the wudu. He has to do the wudu for taking off the khuf all over from the beginning if he takes the khuf. Yes. He said, but he doesn't have to wipe over the hair, over the head, or cut, over the places where the fingernails are cut. I mean, the Awza'i saying here is more acceptable than the others. Being wudu, part of the wudu is invalid, but the whole wudu is not invalid. This is something that when you come to opinions and qiyas, and we don't know anything in the religion that says part of the wudu is invalid, but part of it is not. And this is the saying of Ata'. Al-Awza'i said regarding the one who do mas'h wiping over the imama, he said he must wipe over his head. Just wiping over the head. I mean not repeating the wudu. This is the saying of Ata', actually. Awza'i is like Awza'i, he narrates from Ibn Jurayj, from Ata'. Ata ibn Abi Rabah. This is Ata ibn Abi Rabah. When they mention opinion of Ata, that's mean Ata ibn Abi Rabah. If they want to say Ata Khurasani, they will mention his full name. Ali says, as for the saying of Abu Yusuf, taking off the most of his foot from its from the خوف or less than half. So if he said if it's less than half, then he doesn't have to do anything. Like he's taking his up to here and put it back, it's not fine. But if he takes it all or more than the half, then he must take it off and then wash the feet.
So Abu Yusuf is contradicting himself because he said if you cut your nails, you don't have to.
Yeah, but what he says if you take like this is a saw, you take it, you take it up to here, it's fine. You can put it back and you have your wudu. If you take it more than half, up to like here, now you have to take it off and wash your feet.
And then he says, but if you cut your finger...
Yes, that is, everybody says if you cut your finger, but we don't. There is very odd opinions before that says you have to wipe again. I mean, regarding the imama and those who accept wiping or imama, they say it's fine, except for the khuf.
Okay.
So he said, that is tahakkum fi din. This is the Sharia. Like when someone starts say, if you take half or the not half or most of the feet, or this is something, or someone, if you wait a long time or wait a little time, or either he and you ask for the timing. What is the long time? What is the little time? What is big? What is small? If he doesn't give any limit, then he doesn't know what he's talking about. If he gives a limit with from no Quran and Sunnah, this mean he is. Giving limits from his head and making religion from his head. So he said Abu Yusuf said here regarding most of the feet, half of it, more than half, he said this is just talking in religion with no proof from Quran or Sunnah. So because he said sometime they say a lot is more than half, sometimes they say a lot is the third. Like if we find this, they say, okay, if there is a lot of blood on the clothes, then you should repeat the prayer. What is a lot is more than the third. Sometimes these Hanafis.
Yeah.
Third of what?
Third of the clothes. Like the blood. If there is if it's blood of an animal, then if it's like the dinar, dirham of Baghli, they call it dirham Baghli. If it's the coin, which is from Baghlan, then it's fine. You can, more than the, less than a coin, it's fine. You don't have to repeat the prayer if you find blood that is from an animal or from the body. If it's from the blood of the fish, then it has to be the third of the cloth. Like, things that you don't know where it comes from or person, many people like Ibn Hazm when he start discussing them sometimes, he say this person should have taken some
medication.
Maybe he was hallucinating when he was talking. And it's true. Because you can't find anything. He said sometimes they say a lot is more than half. Sometimes they say a lot is the third. Sometimes they say it's quarter. Sometimes is they say one spam of a hand on one spam. Like you say sometimes they say it, a dirham. You say that all this is like nonsense. As for Malik, saying that taking the foot up to the place of, up to the, Malik said this had, if you take it up to the mawdi' al-saq, it's like this, then it's fine. You don't have to. But if it's more, then you have to take it off. He said also this is making a religion without proof. He said this is making a religion without proof and shouldn't be considered because he has no proof for that. Shafi'i said something similar, that to the point of where the saq starts is fine if it goes up to here, but if it goes below, then you have to do the wudu again. He says all these are sayings that doesn't make sense, it has no proof in Quran Sunnah and should be just ignored. He said as there difference, making difference between mash on the khuffain and then taken off that will not, that will have, that will invalidate the masḥ, and he has to complete the wudu. And between doing wiping over the hair and then cutting it off, or washing the hands and cutting the fingernails, and they say the ghusl doesn't go out. You say this is like contradiction.
You said you should say that the ghusl is incomplete as well. The ghusl should be, if you follow that thing, that the wudu is affected, then
yes,
the ghusl should be affected.
You say that the, now you have a place in your hands,
yes,
that has not been touched with water.
Yes.
You have something on your head, your head. You wiped the hair, your hair is gone now. You throw, you have your head, you have not wiped over your head.
Yes.
You wiped over the hair. And then you cut your hair. You say this is something that talking about in religion without proof. What if someone comes and say, no, if you take your shoes, your khuf off, that will not invalidate your wudu. But if you cut your hair, that will invalidate the masḥ of your head. He said, they are making claim, he is making claim. What is the difference between this and this?
Mm.
Like making claim without proof. You said, what is the difference between someone who says the opposite of what they have said? No difference. He said, we have not found for them anything from Quran and Sunnah. And we found that the wiping over the head and washing over the feet in the wudu, it is for the head, not for the hair. When you wipe over the hair, normally you are wiping for over the head, because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, مسحوا برؤوسكم, wipe over the head. He didn't say wipe over the hair, but the heads are covered with hair. So when you are wiping, it's still in Arabic language, wiping, you don't have to touch. So, but the person is wiping over the, his head, and his head, he still have it, so that's me. It's fine, his wudu is still valid. Same thing when you are wiping over the feet, you are not wiping over the socks. Your intention is to wipe over the feet, because there is nothing to say, that says you have to wipe over the socks. He said, what we found that the wiping over the head and washing the feet in the wudu, it is to wipe the head, not the hair. And also, when you wash your feet, is to wash the fingers, not the
nails.
The nails. Yes. He said, when you have cut the hair and...
So someone has nail polish on them.
No, actually, it's not Ibn Hazm saying this. He said, they have no proof, except that some of them have said,
okay,
that when you wipe the head and you wash the feet in the wudu, that you are wiping over the head. So it's not for the hair. And when you wash the feet, you are not doing it for the fingers, for the nails, it's for the fingers. So when you cut the hair and you cut the fingernails, wudu will stay. As when you wipe over the feet, you are wiping the feet, not the you are wiping the khuf, not the feet. You understand? The person who is doing wiping over the khuf, he said, they say you are doing wiping over the khuf, not over the feet. And your attention is to wipe over the, like you are applying the wiping over the khuf. He say, if you take them off, then the feet are now without wudu, because your intention is to wipe
the socks.
So he is washing, praying with two feet that have not been wiped or washed. So he has no complete wudu. Abu Muhammad says this is nothing, because talking in a religion without proof. He said if someone else says the opposite, no, he was wiping over the head and washing. No, the wiping over the head and the washing of the nails it is for the hair and for the nails. He said, because if there was on the hair, henna, you know henna?
Yeah, the dye.
Color, hair color.
It's not the color itself. It's what makes the color.
The muddy type of texture.
Yeah.
I know henna, but I don't know in English, but I know henna.
Yeah, but it was not the color. I mean, we call it color. We call it, still call it henna when it's the color. When you wash it. But the henna is the
paste.
The paste that you
the
put.
Material, yeah, yeah.
So if he said if he had this paste, he said the proof that if he had paste on the fingernails, his wudu will not be valid. If he had henna on his hair or on the fingernails, his wudu will not be valid. If you say that the wudu is for not for the fingernails, it's for the hands or the fingers, then he said if you have something on the fingers, his wudu will not be invalid anyway. So you know the woman who put manicures or something, they have not washed their hands because there is something barrier between. So if they say, oh, he didn't mean to wash his fingernails, it was to wash the hand. And the fingernails that are like they are barrier. That's why we wash them. We meant to wash what's below. So he said, okay, if it's that barrier, then putting another barrier, like putting henna on them, it won't harm, because what you are trying to wash is you can't reach it anyway.
So who says this?
Ibn Hazm says, answering to their, they say. When we wipe over the socks, we are wiping over the socks. But where we wipe over the hair and over the finger, when we wash the fingernails or wipe over the hair, this is trying to, our intention is to wash the hand, not the fingers.
Fingernails.
Our intention is to wipe the head, not the hair. So we have done, even if you take them, you wiped over the hair. Your intention is to wipe over the hair.
No, but so when you get to the henna, it's okay for them to have henna on. They're saying it's okay.
No, they don't say it's okay. They say, this is what they say. They say, when we wash our hands in wudu, we don't mean to wash our fingernails. It's just because the fingernails are there. No, this is just argument.
This is his argument.
No, this is their argument.
About if you did have it wouldn't make a difference then.
They say normally we are not trying to wash our fingernails. We are trying to wash what is below the fingernails. This is just an argument, like someone who doesn't have an argument. They say we are trying to wash the hands. These fingernails are like extra.
Barrier.
The hair.
Yeah.
Taken off, it won't harm. But because they are like a barrier, when we wash them, we are washing them
With the intention to wash
which is below the fingernail. That is what they say. So he said, if this is the case, that means it won't harm to have anything on the fingernails, because the barrier is there anyway.
Okay.
So we wash the hands. He said, and this doesn't make sense, because they don't say that you can wash, that you can have something on the fingernails and wash over it. He said, so if someone put it the opposite way and say, mash on the head and washing on the fingernails, it is not for the head and for the fingers, it's rather for the hair and for the fingernails. He said, this person will not have, there will be no difference between what they are saying and what he is saying. They are making claim and he is making claim. He said also he has an argument here, because he will say that if there is on the hair henna, for example, and on the fingernails, then they should be, the wudu is invalid anyway. But the truth is, if there is henna on the hair, the wudu, why should it be invalid?
Because the head.
Well, if there is henna on the head and someone wipe over it, whether there is imama or not,
he is wiping over his head.
He said, as for the khuffain, it is the, we want to do mash on the feet rather than on the khuffain. He said, because the khuffain, if it wasn't for the feet, we will not wipe over them. Because if there was no khuffain over the feet, we will wash the feet. So he just arguing with them. I mean, if the person says we are wiping over the khuffain, okay, so you take them off and wipe over them.
Yeah.
If the mash is for the khuff, not for the feet, take them off, wipe on them. I mean,
put them back on.
You understand? And put them when you need them. He said, and let's say that you are right, that the mash on the khuffain is not on for the feet. And that the mash on the head is not for the hair. So that the mash is for the khuffain, for the feet. But for the head is for the head, not for the hair. And for the hands is for the fingers, not for the nails. So what? Who said then that you have to repeat the mash? Let's say that in the wudu, for example, that instead of washing, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, instead of washing like the feet, instead of cleaning the feet, you have to clean the socks. And then you have completed your wudu. Then who said that afterwards, when you have taken the socks off, that you have to repeat the wudu? As for the saying that he is praying with two feet, that they are neither clean, washed, neither wiped, he said that is not true. We say that is not true. He is praying with two feet that they were wiped over when they were covered with khuffain. So their saying is invalid. He said also, when they say that he has to wash his feet only, this is invalid, clearly invalid, because they agree that his wudu was valid and complete, and that he had the right to pray. And then he took his khuf. And then you said, now your wudu for your feet is invalid. He said, this is only, there is two cases here to discuss. He said, either the wudu that he had became invalid or not. There is either wudu is invalid or not. If the wudu was invalid, he said, if you say that the wudu did not become invalid, and this is what we say, so why does he have to do wudu again or do anything? And if his wudu became invalid, then he must do the wudu all over again from the beginning, not just his feet. He said, because we don't know about, we have never heard about any wudu that part of it will be invalid and part of it doesn't become invalid. He said, this is nothing in the Quran or in Qiyas or any opinion, like meaningless, meaningful opinion. Like nobody, what they are saying here is that has no, yes.
Would any of these people who have a up, like opposed to the idea, said that there's such thing as a part affected or defective wudu. Would they say that ever? Like
what?
Explicitly, or they just saying it implicitly?
Well, this is here what he, I don't remember that they say that wudu will go part.
Mm.
If someone breaks his wudu, his broken.
Okay.
This is the only case. He said, so all these sayings, the saying of Abu Hanifa, Malik, Abu Yusuf, and Shafi'i, are invalid. He said only two sayings are valid here. It's either our or the one of Awza'i that says the wudu is invalid altogether. He said, we looked at that in the Quran and Sunnah, and it is proven clearly with the Quran and Sunnah that whoever does wudu and do mash on his imama or in his khuf, that his wudu is completed. He has no more hadith, and the prayer is valid, he can pray. He said, and everybody agrees, like it is ijma'. He said it is ijma'. Everybody agree with us that whoever does that, does wudu and wipe over his head and his khuf, leather socks, and then he takes his khufs on the imama and wipe his head or cut his fingernails, he said everybody agrees that whoever does wudu and then he wipes over his fingernails or imama, that his wudu is complete. And then some people said, if he takes them off, his wudu became invalid. But others said his wudu didn't become invalid. He said, so we looked at it, we found that cutting the hair, cutting off the fingernails, taking off of khufayn and imama are not called in the Arabic language or in the Sharia hadith. You see the hadith of the Prophet, لا يقبل الله صلاة من أحدث حتى يتوضأ. Allah will not accept the wudu of someone who has done hadith until he does wudu. Hadith in the Arabic language is breaking the wudu in the form that is known to be broken in the Sharia generally. Or hadith in the Arabic language means, in the Sharia, means someone who does something horrible, like something bad. You understand? A sin. So the Prophet says, Medina is haram from such and such place. من أحدث فيها حدثا, whoever commits hadith in it, أو آوى محدثا, or he harbor or gives shelter to محدث, فعليه لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين. This is someone who commits a major sin. Someone who commits like getting حدث من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه. Whoever does something in our religion which is not from it, بدعة. So this is the حدث. And the Prophet said, whoever commits has حدث, then he should do wudu. Only for حدث you should do wudu. So if someone has wudu previously, he shouldn't do wudu again unless there is hadith. You understand? Taking off the socks is not called hadith. Neither in Arabic language, neither in the Sharia. The Sharia doesn't refer to it as hadith. So he says,
You said hadith is sins.
Yeah.
So certain sins, as well as the known things that would break your wudu, certain sins would also break your wudu.
Well, this is the most strongest opinion. This is the saying of Aisha, Ibn Mas'ud, and Ibn Abbas amongst the Sahaba. There is no other Sahabi who says something different. There is no Sahabi who said doing a sin will not break your wudu. However, we know that the wudu, the hadith of the Prophet, so many hadith from the Prophet, says, you see the definition of hadith. According, when the Prophet said, لا يقبل الله صلاة من أحدث حتى يتوضأ. And then this is the hadith narrated by Abu Huraira. Abu Huraira, when he was asked, he explained it to his way, but he didn't say it's he didn't mention sins. But according to the Aisha, for example, Aisha used to say, people will do wudu from eating food, pure food, but they don't do wudu from saying a bad word. Ibrahim al-Nakhai also, he says, and he took the opinion of Ibn Mas'ud, that if someone backbite Muslim, he should do wudu. He said, I don't know hadith which is more worse than backbiting. Ibrahim al-Nakhai and Ibn Mas'ud. So, yes.
I spoke to you once about this, yeah. But there's the clear things that break your wudu.
Yes.
Yeah, and now you're talking about haram things that can break your wudu.
Yes.
So if I, for example, if I shave my beard, or if I don't lower my gaze,
yes,
does these things break my wudu?
You see,
because it's not specific.
There is before the wudu, and there is after the wudu. Someone has shaved his beard. He's not shaving his beard all the time. He shaved his beard and it's finished. He committed the sin.
Yeah.
So he committed the sin when he shaved his beard that time. Then there is nothing he can do about it.
Yeah.
If someone has done wudu and shaved his beard, he has committed sin after the wudu, which invalidated his wudu, probably. This is the opinion of the Sahaba that we know. And this is the strong opinion, because the Prophet says that when a person prays and he stays in his place, in the same place, the Malaika will pray over him.
Yeah.
They will say, oh Allah forgive him, oh Allah have mercy on him, as long as he doesn't do hadith. Do you say that if someone breaks his wudu in any way that we know that breaks wudu, that will in the Malaika will stop? The Prophet says the Malaika will pray as long as, so this is the only thing that will stop the Malaika praying over him if he commit hadith. Now the hadith here, if it's only, okay, if we have to take it the way it is known in the Arabic language, that if he breaks his wudu, okay, the Malaika stop praying over him, he must go and do wudu and come back. What if he stays in his place there, doing anything, but he's starting backbiting Muslims, cursing people who don't deserve to be cursed, lying, the Malaika will be staying, stay and pray over him. Why? The hadith says only if he does hadith. Well, this is hadith. And if you have a word, to see, generally, any word in Quran, or in the hadith, you have to take all the meaning of it, unless you have proof to show that this meaning here is not meant, like it's not. You understand? Do you understand this point?
Yeah, I understand.
Like the Prophet said about Medina, the people in Medina, to do a hadith.
Yes.
It's not like if they break wind that they're going to,
yes,
the angels cursing them.
Definitely, that is not meant there. I mean, the word.
So is that why you take the understanding that if someone in the mosque does a hadith, you yourself maybe understand that you wouldn't take the.
No, you have to take all the meaning,
yeah,
for the person who is in the mosque. Because there is nothing to say that one meaning is the invalid.
Okay, let's say someone continuously does something, and the intention is not to stop it, i.e. he works in a bank.
Yes.
Yeah? So he's committing sins.
Yes,
like
his prayer will be always invalid, except the prayer that when he is praying,
he forgets.
He is not thinking about, I am going back to the bank.
But his intention is always to go back to the bank. So his intention doesn't change.
No, but he is praying. He is praying. He is praying now, and he during the prayer he is not thinking about it.
But you said before, if someone's intention,
yeah,
is to do something,
yeah,
when he's on a journey,
yes,
or in whatever scenario,
yes,
he would have to repeat the prayer because of his intention.
Yes, I say because of his intention, because he is thinking during the prayer, he's doing a sin during the prayer. You see, if he doesn't think about it during the prayer, he prayed the way he is supposed to pray, four rak'ah, with wudu, with everything. During the prayer, nothing happened, he didn't think about it.
khushu.
So he was thinking about his prayer. He never thought about, oh, I am going to complete my journey. If he's during his prayer, this have, I mean, during the prayer, he's not walking towards the sin. And he's not thinking about the sin. During the prayer, he stops. If he is walking towards the sin, he's doing something haram. But he is not. He stopped and he is praying. So he's not doing anything haram. He is just praying. He is in his place. And he didn't think about it. During the prayer, said Allahu Akbar, he stopped thinking about, oh, I am good. But let's say he remembered that I am going to go there. And it's not like he fought the thought, no. He decided, yeah, I am going. And he made now the decision that, okay, I'm going to continue. Like, when you are thinking about something to do, you have not done it yet. You're always thinking, when it comes to your head, either, okay, I'm going to continue it or I have to stop it. So he thought about it and he decided that he is going to continue. That is another sin.
This is a big issue. So this means the person who works in an off-license or a shop...
He must pray and his prayer is always invalid. What if someone drinks alcohol? Someone who... Astaghfirullah, not to drink alcohol. Someone who visit soothsayer. His prayer valid?
I thought he was a careful, to be honest with you.
To your future, touch your hand.
How is it? 40 days? Well, done this one.
Well, there is hadith that says 40 days.
Yeah, that's
it. It's not the sahih.
For the one who visits the Susa.
Yeah, yeah. That his prayer is not valid.
But you still have to pray.
He definitely has to pray.
Yeah.
Disobedience.
Having.
Man, but let's say.
But then you got the hadith. The difference between Muslim and kafir is salah.
Yeah.
It's a big issue.
Yeah, the difference between kafir and Muslim is salah. Yeah?
Then. It's like, see, kuffars don't pray.
Yeah.
And if a Muslim is doing acts, like, if it's haram, he's still praying, he's not accepted. It's not confusing, it's just, it doesn't.
Well, praying, but it's not accepted, that's all.
And you still have to, but you have to. Because I know people, they tell me a story, they say, like, for example, say now you have friends, yeah. And they, every night, Friday night, they go out, they do whatever. Now, say one of them, he goes out with them, he does the same things, but he knows he still goes masjid.
Yeah.
He's better than them, because he's praying.
Look, he's probably better than them, I'm not talking about that. You see, the Prophet said, لَا يَقْبَلُ اللَّهُ صَلَاةَ مَنْ أَحْدَثَ حَتَّى يَتَوَضَّ. Allah will not accept the prayer. Someone who has committed hadith, until he does wudu. Also, the Prophet said, لَا صَلَاةَ لِمَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَعْ بِأُمِّ الْكِتَابِ. There is no prayer for someone who has not read the Fatiha.
Yeah.
So there is no prayer. Now he will stand up and pray. We see him praying, doing everything, and then we say, you have not prayed. Forget about the Fatiha, because Fatiha is part of the prayer.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But the wudu is not part of the prayer, it's before the prayer. Now the person will stand up and say, Allahu Akbar, face the Qibla, do everything. But he has no wudu before, we say, you have not prayed. Because this is what the hadith says.
Yeah, yeah.
Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. The prayer that, of course, some people will say, okay, what if he does not stop afterwards? He prays, but afterwards, well, his prayer, when he did it without fahsha and munkar, it was complete, it's done, now it will not be invalidated again. But then it's what for the future. Like this with fahsha and munkar, always, before the prayer comes, you must do tawbah and forget everything that happened before. Anytime that he thinks about in the future something that I am going to continue, I am going to do this in the future, he every time he must think about it. A person, what is it very difficult to understand that many people have no prayer, they don't pray at all. What's the wonder about it? This is what the Quran says.
Yeah.
You understand? They pray, but they don't. Many people do it. A majority of people, yeah. But the religion is not taken like this. The majority of people do it. That's why you have to take the religion to make it to accommodate these people. It doesn't work like this. I mean, the fasting is clear. The Prophet says, "من لم يدع قول الزور," who doesn't leave the saying of this, say, what's the idol top?
Yes.
This Tawla Zor.
Yeah, the waist and the.
Zor is something that is.
Lagwa.
No, Zor, anything that is.
Valid or?
No.
Nonsense top.
No benefit.
Just if you give me just 1 minute to start, try to think about it. Zor is something that is not. You see a woman putting invalid hair.
Yeah.
Fake hair.
Zor is fake. Like Shahadat Zor. So whoever doesn't leave the fake talk and acting on it. Now every haram is fake. Every lie or ghiba or namima or talking about anything haram and acting on it, open it, Allah doesn't need him to leave his food and drink. So this is a clear hadith. And the way the Allah said don't eat and drink during fasting, fasting is to stop something. That is fasting, stopping anything. But Allah said during fasting, don't eat and drink. Drink and eat until you see the white thread from the black thread. And the Prophet said, if someone is fasting, he should don't do jahl. Jahl, which is haram, any act of haram. And not touching woman. Why do you say if someone eat or drink or have touched woman, then his fasting is invalid? But if he does haram, I mean, it's forbidden to talk, to talk haram or to do haram. It's forbidden to eat and it's forbidden to drink. Why when someone drinks and eats, his fasting is invalid, but when he does anything haram, no, his fast is valid. Just because, oh, you look at what's happening in the world, the majority of people do haram. If we say this, it's like the people who decide, we look at the people and make the religion. It doesn't work like that. Most of the people will not be fasting, that's all. That's what we have to say. And they have to try to do it properly.
So generally, we take all sin to be hadith.
Sins are hadith, yeah. The sins that are small sins, these are forgiven automatically. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرَ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهِ. If you keep away from the kabair, you kafar ankum sayyatikum. Now, the small sins, looking at a woman is more likely to be a small sin. You understand?
Yeah.
There is this hadith that looking and walking towards touching all this, a man came to the Prophet and said, I met a woman and they have done everything except like have not committed adultery. He said, did you pray with us? He said, yes. He said, go ahead, Allah has forgiven you. Now, Allah does forgive prayer forgives the small sin.
Yeah, yeah.
The Prophet said that. So, looking at a woman probably is a small sin, which will be forgiven. However, a major sin, as long as it's not done during the prayer, of course, during the prayer, the prayer will make...
forbid you from
the what you do in prayer is the prayer will make the sins, the small sins that you have done before, to be wiped away. Not what you do during the prayer. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
You know the hadith of no salah is accepted in committing hadith. Where is it? Bukhari or?
لا يقبل الله الصلاة من أحدثه. Allah will not accept the prayer of this one. This is Bukhari and Muslim hadith of Abi Hurairah. Yes.
The one about Medina.
It's still in Bukhari as well. The book of Medina, the Fada'il of Medina. Bukhari and Muslim. Okay, so we go back to the... He said, and there is nothing... So if, he says that shows that the person who has done wudu, he is still on his wudu. There is no proof that says that his wudu is broken. He shouldn't have to do wudu again. And whoever says that you have to do wudu again, he is like anyone who says, ask someone to do wudu for any other reason. For example, say, if you walk, you have to do wudu. If you talk, you have to do wudu. If you take off your qamis, you have to do wudu. You say, all these are nonsense, have no proof of Quran and Sunnah, should be just ignored. And Mas'ala 220, He said, and whoever wear his khufayn on tahara intentionally to wipe over them, or put on his feet like henna and let it dry, or put some medicine and put khufayn on them, or put henna over his head, or put any medication and then wear imama or khimar so he can wipe over them, he has done good thing. I mean, he's looking for the permission of someone wears his khuf intentionally to wipe over them. I mean, of course, the Saudi madhab says, oh, if you don't need that for that intention, then you shouldn't, because you are looking for easy things, and for them, it's the religion is hard things. He said, because the religion, the nas, the statement of Quran and Sunnah, the nas here always means either statement, Quran or Sunnah, or both. He said, because the statement of the religion have permitted masih generally, with no exceptions. And he didn't, the religion didn't say that if you do it intentionally, or if you just do it, you are putting your feet without thinking about doing masih. The religion doesn't say that. He said, and Allah doesn't forget. So it's fine if someone wipe over his put his khufs just for him, who he will be able to wipe over them. He's looking for the easy way. He said, it's still fine. He said, we heard from some of mutaqaddimin that says whoever does wudu and then wear his khuf so he can do mash on them, then he shouldn't do mash. It's haram for him because his intention was only to try to avoid to wash his feet. He said, this is mistake and claim without proof. And every say that has no proof from Quran and Sunnah is invalid. You understand? So if someone, for example, is looking for, let's say, okay, someone is going to do wudu, or he knows that wudu is going to be broken. Someone is about to eat something that he's touched fire. So what he does, he wear his socks. He eat, wipe over the socks and take them off. Is he playing with religion? No. Allah has given him permission and he's doing it. He's not playing with religion, trying to bring something to the religion, new to the religion. That is playing with religion. To take the permission and try to avoid something haram. That is, if you look at the Prophet, the way he was dealing with the religion, that is exactly what he was doing. Trying to find the easiest way for the people, the easiest solutions. I mean, you can never play with Allah. If he want to stop something, he will stop it. And he know how to best how to stop it. So, the Mas'ala 221. He said, whoever does Masih in the Hadar while he is resident and then traveled. Someone who is resident,
yeah,
start wiping.
Yes.
This day, today you are resident and then you start wiping,
yeah,
and then you travel.
Okay.
Now, is it like one day and one night or 3 days?
Good.
Of course, they have to deal with it. I don't have to care about it, to think about it, because I don't believe,
yeah,
in the timing anyway. But let's say he said, and then he travels before the end of one day and one night. He said he should do masih until he finishes 3 days and three nights.
So if he's gone through half of a day,
he started one day.
Yeah.
He done masih one day.
Yes.
And then he started traveling. You understand? He will have to continue 3 days. It will be from the beginning, from the time that he has started until the time he has to stop, that will be 3 days.
So when he started as a resident to when he or as,
yeah,
a traveler?
He started as a resident, so he has done one day. He didn't complete his one day and one night.
Yes.
Just before he finished one day and one night, he started traveling. Now he has to ignore the one day and one night and continue 3 days.
Oh, ignore it, okay.
You understand? No, it's not ignore what he has done. ignore the one day and the one night, the rule of one day. So he will count one day and continue 2 days and three nights. You understand? So he said he must complete altogether 3 days and three nights. And after that, he shouldn't do masih. And if he starts wiping during travel, and then he comes to a place where, to his place of residence, he said he can do masih one day and one night if he has not completed his 3 days. To complete his 3 days. But he shouldn't do masih more than that. But if he has done less than 3 days, but more than 2 days and two nights, he must just complete 3 days and three nights.
Okay.
So in all cases, he must complete 3 days and three nights.
Okay.
No more.
Even if he's not a traveler, he's a resident.
He said he was traveling.
No, he traveled, he reached his destination, but he completed more than 2 days.
Yeah, as long as more than 2 days, he has done more than 2 days in travel, then he can complete 1 day and one night in his residence.
To finish the travel?
To finish as three. But if he has, let's say, done less than 2 days and two nights, that is something different. He is talking about if he has done during his travel either 2 days and two nights or more.
This is Ibn Hazm's opinion.
This is Ibn Hazm's opinion. He says, if he has done masih in the travel, 2 days and two nights or less, he must complete. He must do 1 day and one night when he got to his place.
Okay.
If less than 2 days and two nights. If it's more than 2 days and two nights,
he must finish up his three.
He can finish his three. Do you understand?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So he said, if more than 3 days and less than 3 days, but more than 2 days, he must complete his 3 days. And then he can't do masih. If less than 2 days and two nights, he must just do one when he got to the place of residence, do one night and 1 day. He said, as if he has done masih in the safar 3 days and three nights, he must take off his khuf or whatever he's wearing when he comes to place his residence. If he has completed his 3 days and three nights.
And he arrives at his residence.
And then, yes.
Okay.
And he must wash his feet first. We say this, he must wash his feet first before he put his socks again. We say this is clear mistake according to his rules.
Mm-hmm.
Because he says, when the 3 days are completed, you are still having your wudu.
Yeah.
So if he has his wudu, that means his feet are clean.
Mm-hmm.
And then if he takes them off and put them back, he put them while they are clean. So why does he say, you have to wash them?
Probably think.
So he said the proof for that the Prophet has not given permission for masih except 3 days for the traveler with three nights, and 1 day and one night for the resident. So it is yaqeen that he has not given permission for anybody to do masih more than 3 days and three nights. Neither the traveler, neither the resident. And he has forbidden only to start the wiping, not about praying with the masih. I mean, what we were forbidden 3 days and three nights is the wiping rather than the prayer. He didn't say that in 3 days the wudu will be broken. That's what we are talking about. I mean, after 3 days, three nights, if If someone wipe for 3 days and three nights, then after 3 days and three nights, his wudu doesn't become invalid automatically.
Mm.
You understand this point?
Yeah.
Like, let's say you have started wudu last night, and then you do wudu today, and you have been wiping over all the night yesterday and today, all day until Maghrib, and then after Maghrib, it's the end of your 1 day and one night. Doesn't mean that your wudu is broken automatically. Wiping, the Prophet, according to the hadith that they use, that the Prophet said you shouldn't wipe more than 1 day and one night. He didn't say that the wudu will become broken after 1 day or one night. So if, you understand? Let's say you are wiping over your feet. You start wiping today, now. This is the beginning of the day. So that is your day, up till Maghrib. And then from Maghrib until Fajr tomorrow. So you wipe. Every time you need to do wudu, you wipe over your socks. You start from now. Tomorrow after Fajr, tomorrow before Fajr, you do wudu and you can wipe, because it's still 1 day and one night. Then after Fajr, it's another day. Your day is gone. Day and night is finished. Does it mean that your wudu is broken? No. Because you are, according to the hadith that says 1 day and one night. Of course, I don't take it, but let's say you take it. That means still you wipe for 1 day and one night. But doesn't mean that your wudu, after 1 day and one night, your wudu will be broken. You have done wudu before Fajr and your wudu is valid. Now after Fajr, let's say you don't sleep for 3 days, and then you don't break your wudu for these 3 days, you can continue praying because you had wudu and your wudu is still valid. There is different opinions here. Some of the fuqaha say when the 1 day and one night is finished, the wudu automatically becomes invalid. But some of them say no, the wudu is still valid. You understand?
Yeah.
There is different opinions. It's not like the Dahiris or some opinion of the Dahiris. No, they say the Prophet has forbidden the wiping over the feet for more than 1 day and one night. But he didn't forbid the prayer with that wiping for more than 1 day and one night.
Mm-hmm.
You understand this point?
What about if I was to take this opinion, and as a traveler, I did 3 days and three nights, and when I become resident, I don't have to take off my socks because now I'm resident, so I still wipe over 1 day, so it's 4 days. Is there a problem with that?
Well, this is what he's saying. He says
with the first day, then the 3 days, then the last day you were resident.
Exactly. Like, keep travelling, so you travel, you stay at home, so, and it, before it finishes, you start travelling, so you're 3 days. Then you come resident, you come back to your house, then you travel somewhere else.
No, but you've travelled already though.
You already travelled 3 days. You are a traveller.
But I'm saying if you're resident, and then you move again from your residence. Say you're moving back and forth.
Yeah.
There's nothing to say that you have to take off your socks. You could still keep on wiping.
Well, there is nothing to say that you have to take off your socks at all.
No, I'm just saying,
but if you talk that argument, hadith, then it's 3 days and three nights for the traveler.
And then I come back home.
Yeah.
I become a resident. I wipe 1 day. Then I travel back to another country. 3 days, three nights. And I come back home.
But the traveler, when he has completed 3 days and three nights, he must, if he loses his wudu, he must take them off. No matter, he was traveler and he has completed his 3 days, three nights, that is what they would say.
So if you said you didn't lose your wudu and you came to your residence and you still got 1 day and one, you could take that, apply the hadith both together?
No, I didn't say that.
No,
I said if someone has finished his wiping, his wudu doesn't become automatically invalid.
Yeah.
So he can continue praying with it.
Yeah.
I mean, what he can do, if you start now, wudu now.
Yeah.
Let's say from now you wear your socks and you start wiping all day today and all night, the following night, and then before Fajr, you wipe over your socks. Then with that wiping, you can still pray no matter how it takes you, how long. If you don't sleep for 10 days, and you don't break your wudu for 10 days, you can pray for 10 days.
Okay.
Because, you understand?
Mm.
Because It's question of wiping over the socks. It's not question of losing wudu or not.
Okay.
But that's what Ahmed ibn Hanbal said though.
That's what Ahmed ibn Hanbal says as well. Yeah. It's not because they say when you wipe over your socks, this is what Ibn Hazm says as well. This is the opinion also, not everybody, the opinion of many, not like few. They say if you wipe over your socks for one day and one night, after the one day and one night, if you break your wudu, you are not allowed to wipe again.
Yeah.
But if you don't break your wudu, that wudu is still valid.
Yes.
It doesn't get broken automatically.
Yes.
When the time limit is finished. So you can still pray with that wudu for how long it takes you have it.
Okay.
You understand?
Yeah. My question was more that if you're resident,
yeah, we say it. If you are resident one day and one night and you have finished your residency one day and one night, according to the hadith, which is not understandable or it's not da'if or it's probably understanding of someone who misunderstood the statement of the Prophet, it says that you have to, after 3 days, you should take your socks. But that hadith, alhamdulillah, it's not something that hadith... From that hadith, you see the problems
now.
That has created.
Definitely. I'll make more questions on this topic of Qufyan.
I mean, for someone who doesn't believe this hadith to be sahih, all this is useless.
Yeah.
But still, need to read it just to see. He said, the proof for that you can't do more than 3 days at all, whether you are resident or you are a traveler.
Okay.
If you are traveling and then you become resident, or you are resident and become traveler,
yes.
He said the proof that you can't do more than 3 days and three nights is that the Prophet has never given permission to anyone to do masḥ more than 3 days and three nights. Neither for the traveler, neither for the for the resident. And he has forbidden the masḥ for 3 days and three nights, or one day and one night, not the prayer with that wiping. So if he does masḥ in a place of residence, one day and one night, and then he traveled, and then he comes back, before he has finished one day and one night in the travel, or after he has completed it, he shouldn't do masḥ at all. He says, if he does masḥ in place of residency, one day and one night, and then he traveled, and then come back, before he has completed one day and one night in his travel, before he completed one day and one night in his travel, or after he has completed them, he shouldn't do masḥ at all. Because if he does it, he would have done masḥ in place of residency more than one day and one night, and this is haram.
This is haram?
Yeah. That's what he says. If he has been residing in a place for one day and one night, and then he traveled, and he has not completed...
It's 3 days and three nights. He just done one of the days and one night.
He didn't complete one day and night one night in his travel.
Okay.
Or after he has completed them.
Yeah. He returned back home.
And he came back. You see, he says, like if you are a resident, and then you traveled, and between your residence and your travel is 3 days and three nights, is fine. If you are traveling, and then you reside, and in between them, there is only one travel and one
residence.
In between them, there is 3 days and three nights, it's fine. But if you are resident, and you have done one day and one night, then you traveled, and then you come back before the 3 days is finished, and then you shouldn't do.
You should take
home. Because it will be more than one day and one night.
Mm.
And this, he says, and this is because you have done more than with the same masḥ, more than one day and one night. With the same khuf, without taking it off, you have done more than one day and one night. You understand? Abu Hanifa and Sufyan says, whoever does masḥ and then he is resident, if he has not completed one day and one night until he traveled, he can do masḥ until he finishes 3 days.
Okay.
As long as he has not completed in his residency one day and one night.
Okay.
Good sir, can you just say that one more time?
He says, Abu Hanifa and Sufyan say, if someone has done masḥ and he is resident, if he has not completed
one day and one night,
and then he traveled. Of course, if he completed one day and one night, it's finished according to the hadith. Always they say, if he has not completed one day and one night. So he has not completed one day and one night until he traveled. He can complete 3 days with three nights. Yes. From the time he has broken his wudu when he was a resident.
Not from the time he done the masḥ.
No, from the time he has broken his wudu.
This is the same as Ibn Hazm.
No, Ibn Hazm says from the time he has done masḥ when he was resident. From the time he was obliged to do masḥ, from the time he...
Yeah, but that's when he broke it. Okay, so you're saying there's three different periods. From the time that he done it, which is what Ahmed ibn Hanbal said.
Yes.
From the time he was obliged to do it.
Yes.
And from the time he broke it.
Yes.
So what's the difference from the time he was obliged to do it and the time he broke it?
If someone breaks his wudu, he doesn't have to do. Let's say someone breaks his wudu before Fajr.
So Ibn Hazm, I remember you saying this. Sorry, but from the beginning of the prayer or from the end of the prayer? Because he's obliged to do it at the end of the prayer, really, isn't it?
Yeah, but the thing is
not the beginning. Because he isn't obliged to pray until the end of that prayer.
Yes.
Time.
But the thing is. That is one period. I mean, that is Ibn Hazm doesn't count it with an hour. They don't have the watch 24 hours.
No, I'm not talking about
that. They talk about prayer. I mean, prayer that is 1 hour for them. Like the Fajr prayer should be the 1 hour from the dawn until the sunrise. That is one period for them. It's not, they don't count it with the minutes. Like yesterday it was 5:05. Today my wudu, if I do it 5:05, before 5:05 is fine, after 5:05, no, it's not like that. It was the timing when they count is after Fajr prayer is the time until sunrise. After sunrise is time until, this is how they count their timings.
So just before sunrise, it becomes just before sunrise, it's an obligation upon you to do it.
No, we said from the period that it's an obligation, which is measured in time,
so
i.e. Asr, Fajr, that's a period.
How?
Okay.
Ibn Hazm will count,
yeah.
Abu Hanifa, he will count from the time the person has broken his wudu.
Okay.
Ibn Hazm will count it as from the time when he should have done wudu. Ahmed ibn Hanbal will count it as from the time he has done the wudu.
Yep.
You understand?
Which is more accurate?
Of course, if you take it.
Yeah.
Abu Hanifa says you have to, from the time a person can break his wudu, wear his socks, for example at night, break his wudu before Fajr. Abu Hanifa will start counting for him then, before Fajr.
Oh, okay.
So for before Fajr, he will have to until the second day before Fajr. Second, Ibn Hazm say from the time when he should have done wudu, that is between Fajr and sunrise, because he has to pray. So he will start counting for him in that period. Ahmed ibn Hanbal, he says from the time that he has done masah.
Which so is similar to
yes.
Ahmed
ibn Hanbal says if this person is a fasiq,
he stops for a month
and he doesn't pray for a month,
yeah,
he will count from the time he does masah first. You understand? So he can't. He doesn't have to take his shoes for a month or his socks from a month, because he will start counting from the time he has done masah. You see the difference now. Abu Hanifa and say, if he doesn't pray all one day and one night, he still after one day and one night he has to. From the time he has broken his wudu, he has to take his shoes off. Yeah, this is how this is fiqh. They call it fiqh.
Jurisprudence.
Okay.
Thank you.
Let's say what they say here. He say Abu Hanifa says whoever does masah when he is resident, if he has not completed one day and one night until he travel, he does masah until he finishes 3 days and three nights. From the time he commit hadith when he is resident, if he has finished one day and one night during his residence and then travel, he shouldn't do masah, and he must wash his feet. If he travel and does masah one day and one night or more, and then he comes back or he become resident, he shouldn't do masah until he washes his feet. And if he does masah during his travel less than one day and one night and then comes back or become resident, he should complete the masah for that day and that night only, and he doesn't have to start masah for another. You shouldn't do masah for another day and night. Okay, because it's complicated, and I think you have things to do. What we do, inshallah, this small part here, I leave it for tomorrow, because I think you have works to go to, and we complete it tomorrow. And
what page are we on?
The page is 242, and alhamdulillah, inshallah, two pages and it's finished with the khufayn.
What's after khufayn?
Huh?
What's after khufayn?
It's tayammum.
Tayammum.
Tayammum is nice.
Yeah, I know. Alhamdulillah.
I mean, masah al-khufayn, what makes it bad is this 2 days and 3 days, which is not from the religion anyway.
Yeah,
one day and 3 days.
One day and one night and 3 days and three nights.